Welcome back to Sports Econ 101. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Bruce McGowan in the studio and Vern Glenn on the phone.
Hello.
Hella.
Okay, hey guys, let's get
what
ready.
What does hella mean anyway?
Hella?
Yeah, what does that mean, Vern? Hella. What is that? That's become a common phrase now. What does that mean? A common word?
H-O-L-L-A. It's just a slang way of saying holler.
Okay,
that works.
Okay,
so guys, now I know this it's a national show, but there is still a lot of interest in what's going on with Mark Jackson of the Warriors.
Well, the whole thing with him possibly going to New York was interesting. There was a, I don't know if Vern saw it today, but there was an article in the New York Post I saw online where the Knicks would love it if he would leave the Warriors because James Dolan, who's the incompetent, bumbling owner back there, needs to make a big move to augment what he did with Phil Jackson. And I don't doubt if Mark Jackson became available to you, Vernon, that he would go to New York. And the only thing is, would the Warriors really fire this guy? I mean, they'd have to fail miserably and not make the playoffs, I would think, because the fans love him, the players love him, and he's been the best thing since sliced bread. He took this team from being irrelevant to being one of the most exciting teams in basketball. It's a lot of his due. You know, credit
to him. We're all enamored with him and the soundbites about, hey, there's going to be changes around here. At his press conference, he's the third all-time leader in assists in the history of the NBA after 17 seasons. And now, boy, it's looking that way, Bruce. He's going to have to go deep in the playoffs.
Unbelievable.
If he's going to go back. And Joe Lacob likes to do it all big and everything like that, but I haven't seen any vote of confidence quotes or anything from him. I've got a couple of players to step forward saying, yeah, we'd like to have him around. But I just haven't seen any management backing of Mark Jackson stepping forward and going, hey, you know. In fact, the last quote I saw from Joe Lacob was that he thought that Mark Jackson was feeling a little bit of the heat, and that was right around the All-Star break.
Yeah, what amazes me about this whole thing, it's very much similar to, although the 49ers, I think, came to their senses. They haven't signed Jim Harbaugh on a long-term deal, but it looks like they're going to work something out. But, I mean, you have a guy like Jim Harbaugh turned the 49ers around. This guy has turned the Warriors around. I mean, there have been other people involved, obviously. It's not on all the coach, but a lot of it is on him. And for them to get rid of him, that would just, I think it would be a huge, not only a huge mistake, but a terrible move in terms of public relations, because this guy, in some respects, outside of Steph Curry, Mark Jackson is the face of the Warriors franchise.
Yeah, but how much of it has to do with the fact that, you know, maybe him going back to his old team, you know?
I'm sure he would. I think he'd love to go back to his old team if the Warriors don't want. I just can't believe Joe Lacob expects him to take this team to the championship. They're not ready to win the championship. Maybe with a little luck they go to the finals, but I don't even see it. You know, they lose to the Clippers or Houston in the first round, which probably is a likely matchup. That's no disgrace in that, and he shouldn't be fired over that, Vernon.
Well, I think Joe is kind of an impatient man, very passionate about this team. He's got to write the checks, and I'm sure he's looking at a team, and there's expectations that he has. And so when they go out and lay an egg against the Knicks, you know, the other night, and then you know, losing some games down the stretch here where they probably should have won to teams that in all estimations, the Warriors should be far superior over.
Yeah, but look at Miami, though. They lost some games they should have won. And I mean, the Warriors are still, they're on track to win 50 games. What does Lakers want out of this guy?
Yeah, but the difference is, Bruce, Miami, they got rings.
Exactly. But Miami's got great players, too. The Warriors don't have great players yet, but they have a very good team.
Here's a philosophical question. If you have a coach, which apparently all of the players love Mark Jackson, right? So he can only encourage them as much as he can. You have to deal with the talent that you have. So how much of it can you even put on the coach? As long as he's not coaching foolishly with time clock and all that kind of stuff, it's the players.
Well, it is the players. But I think in the NBA, as in the NFL, if you bring in a guy that's dynamic, it's a proven fact that he's going to turn a program around. Baseball, I think less so because it's a different kind of a sport. But Vernon, I think, would agree with me on this one that Jim Harbaugh has been a primary reason the Niners have turned around. And Mark Jackson has been a chief reason that the Warriors have turned around.
Well, here's another difference. Jim Harbaugh had head coaching experience. Mark didn't have.
Yeah, exactly. All the more reason to hang on to Mark Jackson.
And even now, Jackson, you know, he relied a lot on his assistants to do a lot of the work. And Jackson, yeah, he would do some substitution and he would make adjustments and timeouts and stuff like that. But for pure X's and O's, and this is how you guide a team, Mark Jackson is not Greg Popovich.
No.
And I think everybody knows that. So I know he's got that going against him. I know there was some dissension with the club because he had to reassign one of his top assistants. There was a little grumbling there. They
Brian Scalabrine.
Last week. So we're not there every day. We don't know. The inner battles of what's happening with the Warriors, but I'm sure if we were allowed to peek behind the curtain and see what was really going on, I'm sure there is more to this story than what we're saying.
No question. And I will say this, guys. I think a lot of it has to do with Mark Jackson wanting to assert his power. I mean, the fact that Mike Malone said, now that he's gone on to Sacramento, said he and Mark Jackson had some friction last year, and he reassigned Brian Scalabrine at an odd time of the year. I think that signals to management, to ownership, that they have a guy who's going to want to be, more in the decision-maker's chair, kind of like what Harbaugh is doing down in with the 49ers. I don't think it's money so much. With Harbaugh, it might be money, but it's also power. And with Jackson, it's definitely he wants control. And to be honest, I don't blame the guy. I mean, he's, as far as I'm concerned, he's not that he's earned it, but he certainly has a right to try to get it.
and speaking of Jackson, just to kind of cast a bigger net, how about what's going on with Desean Jackson?
Oh, yeah.
Philadelphia Eagles, this guy has a career here, can stretch the field, but because of the alleged ties with L.A. gangs, the Eagles, they just go and just drop him. They don't trade him. They don't get value for him. They just outright drop him.
Yeah, I heard the reason they wanted to do that, too, was they didn't feel that the Eagles, if they traded Desean Jackson, they felt that they would be maybe getting in trouble with another team for future, trade possibilities, because they didn't want to lay a guy on the other team who was a troublemaker. Now, in fairness to Desean Jackson, a lot of these allegations, it's a lot of talk. I mean, the guy grew up in Long Beach. I think if you grew up in the neighborhood he did, you're naturally going to have some contact with some people your age, and some of them are going to be gangsters. Does that mean that you're a gangster? I think he's being painted with the wrong, broad brush.
I guess it depends on how much time
you
spend with him.
Well, the report came out is that he knows guys that are these alleged gangsters. He's been in a couple of music videos with two, and then he's been seen in games giving certain gangster signals that are related to the Crips. It's he owns property where there's been evidence of his knowledge and his friendship with some of these guys tied to L.A. gangs, and I the Eagles just want nothing to do with it.
I think more of the reason that they're getting rid of him is I think Chip Kelly just didn't like to have a guy who was more of a me-first kind of player. Chip Kelly's kind of an autocrat, sort of like Belichick used to be, and maybe still is. And if you don't fit his system, you're out of there. And I think that's the big reason probably they pushed him out. And they use that other thing as a pretext, because the Eagles fans are really up in arms over this. I can tell you that. They're not happy about it at all. They understand it, but they're not happy. It would be akin to what's going on with the Warriors. The Warriors make a move to get rid of Mark Jackson, or the Niners do the same thing with Harbaugh, there's going to be an uproar. There's going to be a revolution out here.
Yeah, I'll say this. Hey, Bruce, boy, let's just say you're like the third or fourth guy on the depth chart with the Eagles trying to hang on, and then Chip Kelly goes out and just drops Desean Jackson. You're thinking, damn, if it can happen to him, it can happen to me.
Yeah.
I better go with the program.
Yeah, that's actually, it sends a good signal there, it sends a message. Okay, guys, we're going to cut to our first commercial break, and again, the theme is baseball, since we started the season. All right. Which manager took the Cubs to the postseason in 2008? The first three emails with the correct answer win a free three-day, two-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Email edward@sportsecon101.com the answer to this question. Which manager took the Cubs to the postseason in 2008? And don't touch that dial. Sports Econ 101. We'll be right back.
I think it's Jim Riggleman, but it's funny. I know more about what happened 30 years ago than I do about what happened 3 years ago. You know that one, Vernon? I was thinking Jim Riggleman, but I'm not sure.
I think Edward set this up. I think it's some kind of trick question. I think something happened. Somebody took over an interim and actually led that team to the postseason.
I think you're right.
Who that is, I don't know. But
he's wearing a sly smile right now.
Edward's throwing on the
I I think Edwards wearing a sly smile right now. I think you're right, Bernie.
Yeah.
You guys just know me too well.
I'm going to say Brigelman, but I don't think it's Brigelman. And I don't even remember the Cubs making it to the postseason in 2008. I remember they made it with Dusty. Well, Dusty was the manager. No, he wasn't in 2008. He'd left. He was there. No, let's see. He was there in 03, 04, 05, 06. Yeah, he was gone by 07. 07, he took a year off. Then 08, 09, 010, 11, 012.
Dusty was
the Reds,
what, 09? Yeah, 05.
Well, he was there 5 years. 5 years in Cincy, 4 years in Chicago, and 1 year off.
Yeah, and they're a good buddy in front of the program, Brian Bright.
That's right. You know, the interesting thing about Dusty, he's got one more year to go before he hits 20 years as a major league manager, and I know he wants another year. But right now, he's not working for anybody.
So, yeah.
I'd like to give him a call, find out what he's up to. Are you pretty good friends with Dusty, Vern?
Yeah, when I see him, yeah. As far as I know, he's probably good.
We should get him on the show, Edward. Yeah. He'd be a great guy.
He's around Granite Bay. That's where he lives.
Yeah, no, I bet you he'd love to come on the show. When he's free, I remember in 07, he wasn't working. He did a lot of radio and TV stuff. And I remember I was working at Comcast part-time at the time, and we had him on quite a bit.
Okay.
His baseball collection is beyond belief.
Oh, I know. He is.
You cannot believe the memorabilia he has.
He is.
That's just like locked away and encased in a nice little part of this walk-in, like closet type thing. Looks like a museum.
Does he have trading cards?
Not so much cards. He has a lot of bats and a lot of jerseys.
Oh, interesting.
A lot of gloves, a lot of lineup cards, tons of photographs.
Interesting. I got tons of media guides. And old Sports Illustrateds and old baseball annuals, and of course all these old tapes of games, of Bay Area games on the radio now.
I used to have an old one with Lon Simmons.
Uh-huh. And, fun to listen to.
Oh yeah, it's
fun to listen to old stuff.
Okay, you guys ready? There we go. Welcome back to Sports Econ 101. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Bruce McGowan and Vern Glenn.
It's so weird not having. Oh, there we go. Going to say, it's so weird not having you point to Vern.
I know. I usually point to Vern, and there he is.
Yeah, but he's...
He's on the road doing the Stanford women's NCAA.
Yeah, how about that? Stanford women.
That's
are
right. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
One win away from going to the Final Four again, Vern. How many times has it been now for Stanford women in basketball?
Oh, yeah. You almost like just write them in almost every year.
Yeah.
Just being right around there.
Yeah.
Like Tennessee and Connecticut.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's our first commercial break trivia question. Again, the theme was baseball. Which manager took the Cubs to the postseason in 2008?
I was going to say Jim Riggleman, but I can't remember who took over Dusty's spot. Dusty left after 06, and I think it was the guy who took over, but I think it was Riggleman, but maybe I'm probably wrong.
Okay, that's not right.
Okay.
Vern?
Boy.
Probably some obscure
and
guy.
No, and it's really not. I know you guys, the audience doesn't know this, but on break, you guys thought this was kind of like a trick question, but it really wasn't.
Okay.
As soon as I mention it, you're going to go, oh, yeah, that's right. Okay, you ready?
Well, it's not Lou Piniella.
It is Lou Piniella.
Lou Piniella.
There you go.
He came back briefly. He came back briefly. And they lost in the first round, didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they did. Okay, real quickly, we were talking about basketball. I just wanted to finish up with this because each week I kept saying we were going to talk about this, and we never did. Now, LeBron put up 61 points against the Bobcats. And I'm wondering, do you think this was like his only accomplishment, like a huge scoring day left for his legacy? Because now he's won a couple of titles. He's been MVP. What else is left for LeBron?
I think he should
go back to Cleveland and lead them to the side.
There you go. That'd be a nice legacy.
Yes, he should do.
I mean, if the guy wins another three or four championships, which he wants to do, to be like Kobe or be like Michael Jordan, I mean, that's what he looks to do. I mean, I don't think scoring titles or high-scoring games are what any of these guys are all about. I mean, they'd love to get that kind of accolade and that kind of attention from it, but the main thing is winning. You talk to any athlete, they don't care. I mean, certainly they want to be a regular part of it, but they want to win primarily. And I think that's – LeBron is driven by that. He really is.
Well, if you remember, when they all got together, Bosh and Wade and LeBron, in the very, very beginning, because there wasn't enough passing, they weren't that good. They kept losing a lot of games when they started becoming unselfish and playing like
– And they still have their – they still have their moments, too. I mean, the other night they won in impressive fashion, and LeBron had a big night, scored 32. But, Vernon, I will say this about Miami. I think that they're going to be in the finals this year. I mean, they proved that that they just have too much talent, I think, and Indiana is really starting to struggle. But there's no guarantee they're going to get by San Antonio. San Antonio right now is playing out of its gourd. I mean, the last we heard, they won 18 in a row. And you've seen them, Vern. What do you think of San Antonio?
Well, I'm just trying to figure, how in the world do they do it? I mean, their system is beyond belief. It seems like you can stick any of these guys in there, and they can win games.
Yeah.
So Popovich just has it going on. They're probably going to give Oklahoma City all they can handle.
They're not
to win that Western Conference.
Yeah.
They're not really a young team anymore either.
No, they're not.
They've got a bunch of old guys now.
Well, and then they came into again, I'm talking about our local team, the Warriors, who are a pretty respectable team. They came into Oakland the other night. Parker didn't play. Duncan didn't play. I'm sorry, Parker played. Ginobili didn't play. And Duncan didn't play. And they still beat the Warriors. And beat them, beat them pretty convincingly. That didn't blow them out, but, won the game decisively. So,
Moving on here. Let's see. The NCAA College Players want to form a union. You know about that?
We talked about that last week, and Vernon and I both agreed, and I think you did too, Edward, that this is something that's not going to go away, that's probably going to happen on a limited basis. And I'll be honest with you, I have no problem with it if it has to do with covering these guys' medical expenses, because it sounds to me like the scholarship only covers so much, and a lot of these guys can get hurt. What do you think, Vern?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, we're talking about, you're talking about these Northwestern kids, right? That are employees of the school. And should have medical benefits. Boy, man, if there's a handful of Division I private schools like Stanford's one of those schools. There's a handful of those schools that can really, this could really be an issue if it goes through.
Yeah.
Well, here is the thing that was brought up in the Wall Street Journal, and I was kind of making my own little comments here. College isn't mandatory. Right, the kids can go to work after high school in a trade or profession. But they were looking at this and going, the director of the National Relations Board ruled Wednesday that Northwestern University players are employees of the school and eligible to form the first college athletes union. Okay, so they were reversing the NCAA's long-term stance that athletes are students first and athletes second. And that's where I was coming up with. Yeah, but college isn't mandatory.
Well, the thing is, here's the deal. They offer these kids a scholarship, free tuition. They give them a nice place to stay, like all the kids who get a scholarship. But the kids are making, the football and the basketball players in particular are making money for the university. And 95% of these athletes don't go on to play in the pros.
So then what would the IRS do? Would they say, if they're considered employees with the union, would the IRS start taxing them?
Well, you're the tax expert. I'm not going to begin to even touch that one.
Right now the scholarships are tax-free.
Yeah. But that could be a problem, like you said, Edward. It could be a major problem. But I understand both sides. I'm not trying to say that I'm for this necessarily, but I'm playing devil's advocate here.
So what happens if you are a employee of the university, but let's just say you have five road games in other states, you have to now all of a sudden file a tax return because you work in that other state?
That's what professional athletes have to do.
Yeah, that's right. When the Giants go up to, or the A's go up to Canada and play Toronto, they have to, they have to file it. Income tax.
Also, when they play in Arizona, they have to
file every state that you play.
Everybody has it. There are states that
Texas doesn't have a tax.
And either Washington or Oregon doesn't have it.
Washington doesn't have
a state income tax.
But the other ones, though, they have to apportion it. And here's the deal, is that California taxes you at the highest rate.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say if you make $1 million, but only, $100,000 of that is earned in California. You don't just say, well, then we'll just take 10%, or just report the $100,000 on the return.
Right.
No, the California says, no. You report the whole million, and what's the income tax on that, and then take 10%. So effectively, they get you at the highest tax rate.
Either way. Wow. Yeah. Those guys, they got their hand in your pocket from day one.
One way or the other.
From cradle to grave.
That's the truth.
Well, they're talking here. They said the duties, the athletic program includes 50 to 60 hours a week during training camp and 40 to 50 hours a week during the 3 to 4 month football season. For much of the year, players are told by coaches when to eat, sleep, and train.
Yeah, I don't think I haven't talked to too many pro athletes that played high school or played college college basketball, college football, who didn't have to work their butts off, not only just to make it into the pros, but also just to stay on the teams and stay on top of things. And a lot of us who go to college, kids that are listening to this program, they don't realize what kind of a commitment, and again, I'm not saying, oh, these poor guys, but it is a major commitment for a 19, 20-year-old kid to give up not only 40, 50 hours a week that he's not being compensated for, and expect to study as well. I mean, that's pretty much all your waking time is you're either studying or you're practicing.
I don't know how many guys have outside jobs when they're working.
I don't think, doesn't the NCAA not allow you to have a job while you're going to
college? No, you can't. No, you cannot. You cannot.
Well, when do you have the time anyway?
Yeah, that's true. I mean,
when do you have the time? Unless it's the off season.
Especially if you go to
Can you imagine you're Johnny Manziel and the car dealership gives you a job over the summer? Hey, Johnny Manziel, Chrysler Ford. You know?
Oops.
You would just be a huge draw.
Speaking of Johnny Manziel, do you guys think he's going to get drafted in the first round?
Depends on if they need a quarterback in the team.
What do you think?
Well, the talk now is Blake Bortles could be number one to the Houston Texans.
Wow.
Instead of Johnny Manziel.
Blake Bortles.
So if that happens, boy, Manziel could fall to, he could fall to the Raiders if they wanted him.
Blake Bortles just doesn't sound like a first round draft pick, does it? First round draft pick.
He's got the NFL size, body, makes all the thrills, the throws.
He's good.
He's one of those guys whose girlfriend is more popular than he is.
Oh, that's true. Yeah,
I love that.
Some internet pin-up model.
Yeah. Well, he's got a name, though, that sounds like it was conjured up by some hack sports writer. You know, Blake Bortles.
Yeah.
It's a funny name.
One last thing on this NCAA thing is that, interestingly enough, though, schools are not allowed to hire players.
Right.
So they must attend classes and be enrolled in the college.
Right.
So you have all these little aspects to think about.
Yeah, you lose your scholarship. I remember Chuck Muncie, this is years ago, the late, great Chuck Muncie, played at Cal, used to come into class. He had a guy that would watch him go into class who was monitoring him to make sure he went to class. And then as soon as the guy left, figured, oh, Chuck is in class, Chuck would sneak out the back door.
Sneak out.
And Chuck never finished college. And he went, but to his credit, he went back and got his degree. Really good guy, Chuck Muncie. But he admitted, because he was a big party animal and it probably wrecked his career because he played about 8 years, but he never became the great player he was supposed to have been. And,
he probably slayed every co-ed female he could while he was there.
And, interesting thing about him, he always wore those horn-rimmed glasses. That was very characteristic of Chuck Muncie.
Right, yeah.
That's how you remember him. But what a great runner. That was first Cal team I ever covered. I covered that
San
guy.
San Diego Chargers.
Great
player.
Okay,
and guys, we're going to cut to our second commercial.
And New Orleans Saints.
That's right.
Yeah, he played with both of them, yeah.
Yeah, but he made his real name with the Chargers.
Yeah, so. He was good.
He was good. Okay, again, the trivia theme is baseball. Who won two consecutive batting titles in 1999 and 2000?
For which league? You don't have to give us the league. That'd be too easy.
No, I don't know.
It's
one or the other. It's either the AL or the NL.
Okay, yeah, okay.
Okay. The first three emails with the correct answer win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Email edward@sportsecon101.com. The answer to this question. Who won two consecutive batting titles in 1999 and 2000? Now, Vern, you're not with us here, so I can't watch you. Don't go on the internet. No cheating. Okay. All right. Don't touch
that. The phone has come to my ear.
All right. Don't touch that dial. Sports Econ 101 will be right back.
Was it Rafael Palmeiro?
That would be an excellent guess.
'99 and 2000.
I was going to say, maybe Rafael Palmeiro. It's funny, Vernon. I remember who won the batting title in 1968, but I don't remember who won it last year. I mean, that shows you where my mind is at.
Yeah.
Because those things have a greater impact when you're a kid.
You never heard of this guy.
That's true, though. I mean, I could name you the starting lineup for the Cincinnati Reds in 1961 at the World Series, but I could not name you the starting lineup for the Reds last year. Yeah, 61. Elio Chacon,
well, that's right,
Frank
World
Robinson,
Series.
Chico
Cardenas.
When you say batting titles, you're talking about home runs, average, and RBI?
The batting title would
be batting average.
Yeah, otherwise that'd be a triple crown, right?
Nice batting average.
I don't know if it's right, but I'm gonna say Palmeiro, but I think he was a little earlier.
You have the right league, Doug.
Who hit for average, 99 and 2000?
Palmeiro was right there, but I don't know if it was him.
Huh.
Interesting.
He had a pretty high average, didn't he? He did. But he wasn't doing steroids.
Yeah, Yeah, I think the thing that turned me into a hardcore baseball fan was the Giants of 62. A friend of mine took me to, his dad was an executive sales guy at KCBS, took me to this game two of the World Series, and we sat in what would be considered, but they weren't. But in those days, it was considered kind of the luxury box.
Yeah.
So can you imagine a 10-year-old kid getting to sit in the best seat in the house for the World Series?
Yeah.
And missing school, my parents said, it's okay, you can go.
For that? Once in a lifetime?
Yeah,
sure.
They were nice about it.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah, I remember watching the 69 Mets on TV. We actually watched it during school. It was like during lunch.
We should mention this, and Vern, probably have a good story. I'll tell you a little quick story about that. You tell us your story about sometime here.
All right.
It'd be kind of fun.
Okay.
Yeah. All right.
Here we go.
Listening to the radio or, keeping up.
Okay, here we go. Welcome back to Sports Econ 101. Again, I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Bruce McGowan and Vern Glenn.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The trivia theme is baseball. Second trivia question. Who won two consecutive batting titles in 1999 and 2000?
I'm going to take a guess that was Rafael Palmeiro.
No, but you got the right league. It was the American League.
Oh. Was it a New York
American
Yankee?
Yeah, actually, you'll see. I'm trying to think now. He was in the American League then. He got traded to the National, but at some point. Ready?
Yeah.
Who's married to Mia Hamm?
Oh.
No.
Nomar Garciaparra.
What a couple. Can you imagine the kids they're going to have? How athletic prowess those kids are going to have? My God.
Okay, so off the air, Bruce, you were talking about how you got into baseball excitement.
Yeah, I'm sure Vernon has a similar story, and you probably do too, Edward. When I was 10 years old, the Giants and the Dodgers were in this great pennant race. I went to some games with my dad, but the thing that really got me into it was listening to the radio with Russ Hodges and Lon Simmons, and then a friend of mine's dad was a radio sales executive, and my buddy, tells me at school one day, hey, we're going to the World Series tomorrow. It was game two, Jack Sanford against Ralph Terry. And my parents said, okay. My mom actually said no, and my dad said, no, this is a once-in-a-lifetime. He gets to go. So I got to sit in what would be considered, in those days it was a luxury box, but what is considered a luxury box, at 10 years old, watching game two of the World Series, and I was hooked on baseball from that point on.
And Candlestick was only how old then?
3 years old. Yeah. So it was beautiful. Yeah. And it was for a kid, it was like, this is like the Field of Dreams.
In October, the weather's not too bad.
The weather was very nice, although they did have some rain later in the series that postponed almost a week of the World Series that year.
Yeah.
So interesting. And, of course, the Giants lost to the Yankees in the series 4-3. But in that game, Willie McCovey had a home run. Jack Sanford pitched a shutout, and we all went home happy.
In fact, I remember talking to some people, and they said that he was like probably the most feared hitter. If you were playing first base.
Not at that time in the early 60s. He was just starting to become a feared hitter. But by 69, the year the Mets won the World Series, he was the best hitter in baseball that one year. He had 45 homers, drove in something like 128 runs, and hit .325. And was like Bonds. They used to walk him every other time at bat.
Can you imagine playing first base? I'd hate to have a runner on first and have to hold the runner.
Yeah.
You play a little bit too close.
He hit this long, beautiful, powerful swing, long looping swing, and the balls would just jump off his bat. It wasn't like a line, a high fly ball. It was a line drive, was out of the ballpark like that.
Well, I remember him hitting one out of the stadium.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. And I don't think anybody had hit one out of Candlestick Park.
No, he did that. And he hit one out of St. Louis, the old Sportsman's Park. And I remember Russ Hodges, I'll never forget this is in 62. And Willie was just a 24-year-old. He said, that ball is, out of the stadium, down the street on its way to a hamburger joint. So,
earliest memory of being able to, I actually didn't get to skip school, but during the Amazing Mets, 69, watching Ron Swoboda going all out to make that catch, being in school and lunchtime, they let us watch the series.
Nice.
Back then, they had the games.
I can remember my earliest baseball memory, going to see the Washington Senators host the Minnesota Twins. That had been 1968 or 1969 at RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C., and Ted Williams was the manager of the Washington Senators.
Wow.
Not sure if Armin Killebrew was with the Twins then or not.
Oh, yeah, he was.
But the stadium was so empty. We were sitting out in deep center field, and you could hear the sound of the ball popping the catcher's mitt. It was just reverberating.
How come you didn't just move behind the home plate with all those empty seats? You could have snuck up there, huh? Well, of course, they probably could have seen you because There were nobody other, no yeah. other people around.
Yeah, but back then they let you do stuff like that.
They were kind of, I remember people sneaking into Candlestick Park and getting caught. I had a friend of mine do that once. He got caught and then he got away and ended up watching the game.
Well, you're talking about sneaking into the stadium?
Well, yeah, I was saying, DeVernon, he was sitting out in center field. Why not sneak into the yeah. Box seats where there's nobody sitting? But, of course, if you did, they'd see you much more readily because there's not too many people around.
Well,
so.
you know, it's funny, talking about, like, sneaking around. I had these really good seats for spring training, and one of my clients is, you know, plays for the Padres, and it was awesome.
Will Venable.
Yeah. Because I was able to walk down to and saw the security guard on the field and just ask him, said, hey, can you mind getting Will over here? And he goes, sure.
Yeah, it's a little more informal at spring training. Exactly. Can't do that in the regular season.
No. But it was great, you know, so I got to talk to him for a few minutes.
He had a good year last year, too.
He did.
He signed a nice contract.
He absolutely did. Yeah. But moving on here, the end zone celebration banning spiking the ball over the goalpost.
Well, Ben, what
do you think? That's right, Dave is going to do. He can't spike the ball. He's got a hook jacket or something, hey.
I think Vernon Davis, is the 49er tight end, has got to be thrilled with that because I remember he got blocked by the goalpost or the crossbar a couple times. So he's probably saying, I'm not going to embarrass myself anymore.
Well, but probably the only reason is because the guy bent it.
Yeah. Who was the guy that popularized that, Vernon? Wasn't it Tony Gonzalez?
I think so.
Wasn't it?
Tony Gonzalez, yeah. He used to spike, and then who's the tight end for the guy used to be the tight end for the Saints.
Jeremy Shockey.
Yeah, he used to spike. Yeah. Ronnie Davis spiked, but one of those spikes, he came down on the goalpost and the goalpost got all crooked. So.
I don't think, what are they making, a tinfoil or something? Yeah, maybe these guys are hoping some basketball scouts are watching in case their football career is over, you know?
Good grief. I'll be honest with you, I don't have any problem with end zone celebrations as long as they're not too obnoxious. I mean, you know, you gotta show a little emotion. This is a game of emotion, and I don't like it.
Bruce, you know, it's the NFL, which means
no fun league.
Did you remember the Washington Redskins? They used to take the ball. Whoever scored, the guys would line up on the side.
Oh, they do the.
And the guy would pretend that he's throwing craps.
Yeah, I do remember that. That was pretty funny. I thought that was pretty original, actually.
I would think that the first time I remember was Elmo Wright for the Kansas City Chiefs.
Spiking the football.
Remember he did it with the legs?
Oh, with the legs.
Yeah, the legs going up and up, up.
That's I love Billy White Shoes Johnson. Yeah. The Houston Oilers. Remember that, Vernon, how he used to, with the legs, go out, in and out, in and out? He was so
doing
funny.
Doing the Charleston.
Yeah, doing the Charleston.
Did he later play for the Atlanta Falcons?
He sure did.
He went in touchdown fast. Barkowski to
beat the 49ers
in like 82.
It was early in the
season. 82, 83. In fact,
the last play of the game.
A friend of mine who I grew up with, Stacy Bailey,
he called it too. Yeah.
He was the one who tipped the ball because he had a 48-inch vertical leap.
Yeah. Didn't he catch one against the 49ers and beat the Niners in 91, I think, when Steve Bono was quarterback in the Niners?
Very possibly. I don't remember that. But the funny thing is, he only weighed 175 pounds. So I kept yelling at the TV, don't go down the middle, they'll crush you. So he kept running down, you know, just doing his little button very, very fast.
Well, interesting thing about Billy White Shoes Johnson's touchdown, it wasn't a touchdown, the replay. They didn't have the replay in those days, but the replay showed that he missed. He tried to stretch the ball across the goal line and didn't make it, but they gave it to him, and it didn't cost the 49. Well, it's interesting. They ended up losing that year in the championship game. They might have.
Didn't they have like a great thing going in the late 70s?
Oh, boy.
They were so fun to watch.
They were.
They just could never beat the Pittsburgh Steelers.
No, who could? The Steelers were so good in those years, and that defense was just tough.
Did you guys see the documentary on Earl Campbell?
No, I heard about it, though. I heard it was very good.
Very sad. Just the shadow of his former self, can hardly walk.
How's he doing mentally?
Mentally, he's there.
Oh, that's good. I mean, because he's
fine. It's just,
you hear some of these guys running there.
Pretty much lost a lot of use of his leg.
Yeah, that's tough. I mean, here's some of these guys, their brains are scrambled. Jim Otto, a local guy here in the Bay Area, is one of those guys. His mind is sharp, but his body is just, it's amazing he has survived this long. He's 72.
John Bella.
They take a terrible beating. Can you imagine playing that position on the offensive line or defensive line? You run into somebody every single play. You're running into them and smacking into them, and they're whacking you in the head or hitting you in the chest. Or Oh, God, you'd want to do
like a car collision, like 50, 60 times a game.
Yeah, exactly.
Always in that stance. Yeah.
Well, Vernon knows about that. He back in the day when you were Mr. Involvement on KPIX, you got you went up against, who was it, Jeff Ulbrich?
Jeff Ulbrich, yeah. Yeah, that was my little local George Plimpton moment.
And he didn't hold anything back. He hit you full on, didn't he?
Did you knock him on his hand?
I hope you knocked him on his can.
was he nice enough to extend a hand and say, "Hey, Vernon, I didn't mean to hit you so hard"?
No, he ran over and like, "Hey, you all right?" And everybody else was laughing.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be one thing if you both weighed.
Because the reporter, in full pads, so it's a free shot.
Yeah.
If you both weighed 280 pounds, I mean, that'd be one thing. But I think he had a little bit of an advantage.
Well,
I needed to be built like Maurice Jones Drew.
Yeah.
That would have been a different story.
Well, and the thing is, even though the smaller guys don't get hurt as much because they have less area to hit, but at the same time, your midsection is not covered with any pads. So if he hits you in the midsection or throws you down, your body's taking up more lanes of time. Your body's going to take the full brunt of it.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, the shoulder pads will guard you a little bit, but that's not going to help you forever.
Hey, what do you guys think about the NFL moving the extra point to the 25-yard line?
I like it.
42-yard kick.
I like it. What do you think, Vern?
Vern, you there? Uh-oh. Don't tell me we lost yet.
We lost Vern.
Holy smokes.
Holy smokes. How would Cosell, him, okay. And Glenn.
Well, we're going to have to get Vern back again.
Yeah.
Okay, actually, I like it too. Because right now it's 99.6%.
It's ridiculous.
It doesn't. I know guys can get hurt.
It's like hitting a 1-foot putt. How can you miss?
Yeah.
I mean, it's ridiculous.
Exactly.
What's the point of even having one then?
Yeah.
There's
Vern again.
Vern's back with us.
Are you back with us?
I am back. Okay. Yes, I was momentarily in cellular phone hell.
Oh yeah. I can imagine exactly where you were. So we were just talking about the NFL moving the extra point back to the 25-yard line, making it for a 42-yard kick. What do you think? You like
it? Man shot, why not?
Yeah, I love it. I mean, because
it's a bigger, faster, stronger.
Yeah,
it'll make it interesting.
Now, right now,
it'll make it such an automatic.
That's right. This automatic was 99.6%. Guess what the odds are for being a 42-yard kick?
60%?
No, believe it or not, it's 80%+.
In this day and age,
kickers are so good. Now, the thing is, by the way, the 2-point success rate is about 50%.
Really? It's that high?
Yeah. I was actually kind of surprised at that, too. But I really like that idea because it's just, like you said, it's too automatic.
Yeah.
Guys can get hurt.
Yeah.
I
think the average NFL player, tell me if you think I'm wrong, guys, but I think the average NFL player would love it if they would just get rid of kickers except for punts and kickoffs. And have a 2-point conversion. I bet you the players would love that. What do you think?
Well, not if you're a player, a kicker.
Yeah, I mean, get more action in. These guys want to play.
The long field goals are good, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't get me wrong. I like to see the kicking game, but the extra point from 12 yards away is ridiculous.
Well, you know what? Actually, you don't have to have a kicker kick the from the
12-yard line or 14-yard line.
No. On kickoffs. Why don't you just hit for safety, right? You just have the punter do it.
Yeah.
Because I like to see run backs. But of course, that apparently is the time that everyone gets hurt.
That's true. Well, they're running and flying down the field at a high level of speed.
Okay, guys, we're going to cut to our third and final commercial break. Trivia question. Again, the theme is baseball. Which left-handed pitcher was nicknamed the meal ticket?
Oh, I got that one.
And had a devastating screwball who was elected into the Hall of Fame in 1947. Bruce knows this one.
I'll let Vernon try to answer this one.
Okay.
I bet you won't.
Yeah,
all right. Yeah.
All right. The first three emails with the correct answer and a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Email Edward at sportsecon101.com. The answer to this question. Which left-handed pitcher was nicknamed the meal ticket and had a devastating screwball who was elected into the Hall of Fame in 1947? And I think you knew that just from the word the meal, or the nickname the meal ticket. For me, it would have been the devastating screwball.
I actually interviewed this guy, and I will say this, give you a hint, he pitched back in the 1930s, so he's no longer with us. But I interviewed him many years ago.
Yeah, because if he was elected in 47, then and they still had the five-year rule back then.
Oh, yeah.
I guess it's only Babe Ruth who got in.
Yeah. That's a good point. Yeah, yep. Babe Ruth was, Babe Ruth.
That's right. Yeah, don't touch that dial. SportsEcon101.com. SportsEcon101. We'll be right back for some closing comments.
Carl Hubble.
Charles.
Who was actually Vernon Holder. Did you hear me there, Vernon? I'm sorry.
Say it again?
Carl Hubble. He was actually, he later became the Giants' farm director for many years here in San Francisco. Really nice guy. You know, he struck out five guys in the All-Star game, the very first All-Star game, struck out five in a row. I think it was Jimmy Fox and Cronin and DiMaggio. Ruth Garrick, Cronin, Fox, and one other guy. I can't remember who it was. Pie Train.
And in those days, didn't they play two All-Star games a year?
Well, actually, they only did that for about four or five years in the late 50s, early 60s. I think it was more of a promotion. But no, in those days, they just played the one. And that was the very first one, 1932?
33.
33, wow. God, that's 80 years ago, over 80 years ago.
Amazing.
Time's going by too fast. I'm going to be 62 in a couple months. Today, I felt
I think you love to go back in like a three-dimensional hologram back then, to watch the game.
Oh, I'd love to go back.
That would be awesome.
Love to go. You know, I hate to sound like a romantic, but I would love to go back and just live for a day in the 1960s just to see what it was like again. That would be really wild. You know,
the 60s?
The 60s was a great era. Okay.
For sports.
It could be a whole section of the show. We just named the five events you would like to have witnessed.
Oh, there's a good one.
That's a good one.
Keep thinking about that for the next show.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
Because we'll record two shows next week starting at 3 o'clock. Vern will call it.
There's the five athletes living or dead that you'd invite for a cookout.
Hey, Vernon, I don't know if you have Dusty's phone number. I think I have a phone number or an email. Edward, remind me, and I'll try to get it, because it'd be great to get Dusty on the show. Don't you think, Vern?
Oh, yeah, I'd love it.
No, he'd be awesome.
Yeah. Do you have a contact for him at all?
I know a guy who knows a guy.
Okay.
One of those deals.
If I don't have a contact at home, I know a guy who has one. So
okay.
Right.
I'll give it a shot next week. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm sure he's around.
Excellent. Okay, here we go. Welcome back to Sports Econ 101. Last time, I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Bruce McGowan.
Yeah, it's nice to be here.
And Vern Klein on the phone.
Present.
I remember those days. Okay, our third and final trivia question, baseball, was which left-handed pitcher was nicknamed the meal ticket and had a devastating screwball who was elected into the Hall of Fame in 1947?
Carl Hubble.
Carl Hubble,
that's right, who later became the San Francisco Giants farm director and in the 1933 All-Star game struck out five consecutive Hall of Famers. Among them were Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, I think Joe Cronin, and Jimmy Fox was
Jimmy
one
Fox.
Of them. And who was the fifth one?
DiMaggio started in 36.
Yeah, it was somebody like on the Tigers, like a Hank Greenberg, or no, it wouldn't have been him. I don't know. Anyway,
I'd like to know what happened the second time they went to the lineup.
I don't know. That's a good question, Anna. Good question.
Okay, let's see here. We've got just a little over a minute left. I'm going to go right into our thoughts for the day here, right? In 1998, Serena and Venus Williams said that they could beat any man ranked 200 or worse in a game of tennis. So this guy named Karsten Brasch, who was ranked 203.
Great name, by the way.
Yeah. He accepted the challenge and easily beat them 6-1 and 6-1,
6-1. Wow, really?
Yeah.
Wow. They were just kids then, weren't they?
1998?
Oh, 1998? No, they weren't kids.
No, they were kind of...
I don't remember it. I do not remember that.
Yeah, I don't remember that either, but it kind of reminds me of the Billie Jean King.
Oh, yeah.
But see, this was a little bit...
Well, she beat an old, washed-up Bobby Riggs who was like 65 years old.
Which I didn't think was fair. Okay.
No.
And then, get this, there is a sport called bonsai skydiving. You throw the parachute out of the plane first and then jump after it. Sounds like fun.
Oh,
huh?
Yeah, great. I'm all for that. What do you think?
What the life insurance policy is on
there. Yeah. Vernon used to be Mr. Involvement. That's one thing I think you'll stay away from being involved.
Yeah, hell yeah.
I don't know, guys. I think I already signed us up.
So oh, no.
So if we're still here next week, tune in next week to Sports Econ 101.
Bonsai!
We're going to be discussing sports topics from a business perspective and giving away free vacations for answering sports trivia questions. Thanks for listening. On behalf of our team, I'm your host, Edward Brown. We'll see you next week.
Good night, America.
So long. All right.
Good show, guys.
That was fun.
Oh.